He's risen. He's risen. Hallelujah. Praise His holy name. It is a blessing to be in the house of the Lord for this great celebration that happens around the world. We proclaim that we have a Savior who died on the cross, but He rose again. And the Word of God tells us that He is sitting at the right side of God the Father in heaven. And one day He will come and judge the living and the dead. Amen. We know that He made Himself present with us here in this sanctuary by His Holy Spirit. And as His people, we are invited to stand to worship His holy name. But we are going to start with prayer, and Reverend Roy Victor is going to pray for us.
I invite you to stand with me, please. Precious Lord, we thank You, Lord, for today, especially today, Father, Lord, for we celebrate, Lord, that the tomb is empty.
Yes.
And You had indeed arose, Father, Lord. You arose, Father. Death does not have victory over us anymore, Father, Lord. Father, You rose for someone like me and someone in this congregation, Father, Lord, that's going through a hard time, that's going through depression or anxiety, Father. Father, You died for them. You died for our sins. You died to set us free from the bondage of sin, Father, Lord. And today, Father, Lord, we celebrate You.
Yes.
Father, Lord, You have risen indeed, Father, Lord. You live, Father, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Ask me how. I know He lives because He lives in my heart.
Amen.
He lives in the heart of every single member in the congregation, Father, Lord. And Father, Lord, one day, Lord, we will be resurrected like You were, Father, Lord. If we are in Christ, we are looking forward to that day where we be resurrected. We will be made whole.
Amen.
We will be made perfect, for we will be made perfect,
Jesus,
just like You, for we will see You as You really are, Father, Lord.
Amen.
And Father, Lord, we anticipate that day, and we pray, Father, that if there's anyone here that doesn't know the happiness that Jesus Christ can give, let it be today, Father.
Amen.
And today, we ask these things in the name of the One who died for us, Jesus Christ, still the most powerful name on earth as well as in heaven.
Amen.
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 God, we just want to thank you today. We want to lift you up in song, God. We want to praise your name. Thank you, God, for your blessings. Thank you for looking down on us. Amen. Sent his son, they called him Jesus.
assurance. Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. And born of His Spirit, and washed in His blood, and what He did for me on Calvary was more than enough. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. And He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. Now that's why I trust Him. That's why I trust Him. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. That's why I trust Him. That's why I trust Him.
The moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us. The stain of every curse upon
God was laid in darkness, a battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever broke.
The Lamb has overcome.
worship at Buttonwood Park. Our brother, Reverend Roy, brought you the Word of God. And we were blessed. But there was something that caught my attention about the kids that he said that they asked what would be the first word of Jesus during the moment of his resurrection. And people were waiting, and the little one said, that would be ta-da-da! Ta-da! Yes! That was a moment for the Church of God, a ta-da church! Hallelujah! I'm here! I'm not dead! Church, we serve a risen Savior! We are here not only to repeat traditions, because sometimes we think, oh, we are going to celebrate this every year. This is a powerful message, and happened around the world. All the churches of Jesus Christ around the world, they praise His name. And you heard the word, He is risen! He is risen! Church, He is risen! Praise His holy name! And that's why we are here, to celebrate. When Jesus spoke with His disciples at the beginning, there was no hope. Because Jesus said to them, now it's time. I'm going to be betrayed and someone is going to deny me. But the disciples start to feel hopeless. And even Jesus said to them before that He would need to go. Because if He would not go, He would not be able to send His Holy Spirit. They do not understand. The question, where are you going? Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. This is the hope of the church. There is a place for me. And there is a place for you who say yes to Jesus. And this place, it is in the better place in heaven. Church, we celebrate because the one who one day spoke with His disciples, but they saw that He was being put to death. Some of them said, let us go back to what we used to do. Some went back to the fish. Some were so disappointed. And even there is a group of ladies. And they said, let us embalm the body. No hope. And they went to the tomb. Jesus was not there. The question was, who would be able to remove the rock from the entrance of the tomb? An angel did that. But the one who was dead rose from the grave to bring hope to me and to you. Today, what I want you to understand, my dear friends, is that the Church of Jesus started to move on when Jesus arose from the dead, and days before in Pentecost, the Word of God says that the Holy Spirit came, and the Church of God started to grow, and it continues to grow even today. Last week we baptized 5 people. Today we are going to call them to come and stay in the front. We want to give their baptism certificate. It tells us that there are people who trust God. My question is, do you trust God? Do you, my friend? Do you trust Him? Is Jesus your Lord and Savior? Do you know Him? Today, I would like to challenge you to open your heart to Jesus Christ. I'm going to ask the church secretary. She is going to read the names of those who were baptized last week. And I'm going to give them their baptism certificates. And after that, we also are going to receive the new church members in this church. Around the world, the church of Jesus is growing because they believe that there is salvation in Jesus and hope in eternity in His presence.
Good morning, everyone. I would like to call those up. Can I have Ian David Vajdipina Silver come up? Can I have Pedro Enrique Moise Joaquim Batista?
I want you to come first. You can come right here, okay?
Elena House. August Gomes. And Andrew William Deluge.
Amen. I would like to challenge you that wherever you go, you continue to remember that the baptism is a testimony that you give to the world, that you died for the world, and now you came to live to a new life with Jesus Christ. May God continue to strengthen you and to help you to be faithful to Him. Amen. God bless you. I want you to sit down. Elena, you can go too. Some of those who, the majority of them, are going also to be received as a members of the church. And this is a very important moment in the Church of Jesus Christ. It's a sacred moment because we welcome in the body of Christ those who want to be members of the church. And we pray that God will continue to use them in a mighty way. We are going to have our church secretary calling their names, and I want them to, as they call, please to stand
in front of the pastor. Okay, we'd like to welcome August Gomes. We have Ian Silva. We have Pedro Mois Baptista. Andrew Deluge. And Marie Sylvains. Not here.
Okay. Maybe she's not here yet, but these are the people who are going to be received as members in the Church of God this morning. Dearly beloved, the privilege and blessings that we have in community together in the Church of Jesus Christ are sacred and precious. There is in it such fellowship, care, and counsel as cannot otherwise be known apart from the family of God. There is the godly care of pastors with the teaching of the Word and inspiration of corporate worship. And there is cooperation in service, accomplishing that which cannot otherwise be done. Marie is here with us. Thank you, Marie. Today, we affirm again the doctrines and practice of the Church. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. We believe that human beings are born in sin, that they need the work of forgiveness through Christ and the new birth by the Holy Spirit, that subsequent to this, there is the deeper work of heart cleansing or entire sanctification through the infilling of the Holy Spirit, and that to each of these works of grace, the Holy Spirit gives witnesses. We believe that our Lord will return. The dead shall be raised and that all shall come to final judgment with its rewards and punishment. Today, we affirm again the agreement statement of belief of the Church of the Nazarene, that there is one God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, that the Old and the New Testament scriptures given by plenary inspiration contain all the truth necessary to faith and Christian living, that human beings are born with a fallen nature and care, therefore inclined to evil, and that the finally impenitent are hopelessly and eternally lost, that the atonement through Jesus Christ is for the whole human race, and that whosoever repents and believes on the Lord Jesus Christ is justified and regenerated and saved from the dominion of sin, that believers are to be sanctified, holy, consequent to regeneration through faith in Jesus Christ, that the Holy Spirit bears witness to the new birth, and also that the entire sanctification of believers and that our Lord will return, the dead will be raised, and the final judgment will take place. Do you heartily believe this truth? If so, answer, I do. Do you acknowledge Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? And do you believe that He saves you now? If the answer is yes, say, I do by faith. Desiring to unite with the Church of the Nazarene, do you commit to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself, as expressed by the covenant of Christian character and conduct? Do you commit to the mission of God as expressed in the doctrine, fellowship, and the work of the Church of the Nazarene? Will you support the teaching of the Church of the Nazarene and strive with God's help to grow in your understanding and practice of the same in a way that enhances the witnesses of the Church? Will you endeavor in every way to glorify God by a humble walk, godly conversation, and holy service, by devotedly giving of your resources and by faithfully participating in the means of grace? Will you follow Jesus Christ all the days of your life, abstain from all evil, and seek earnestly to perfect holiness of heart and life in the fear of the Lord? If yes, answer, I will. Because you said that. And because our brother, Reverend Roy Victor, spent time with you, and also I had this opportunity to sit down with you and go through everything that I said here in front of you. Maybe all the people in the congregation did not understand everything, but we want to make sure that you are able to understand. You made the decision to become members of the Church of Nazarene. And as a pastor in this church, I welcome you in the Church of the Nazarene and the fellowship of this local congregation with its benefits and responsibilities. May the great head of the church bless and keep you and enable you to be faithful in all good works, that your life and witness may be effective in care for the poor and oppressed and in leading others to Christ. I welcome you into the Church of God here at the International Church of Nazarene. May God bless you. Welcome. Bienvenue. Love you. Je t'aime. Welcome. Welcome. bless you. Amen, church. Can you welcome these new members? Can you turn? Let us continue to work together to build the church of Jesus in this community. God bless you. You may be seated. Okay. Amen. Praise God. Now is a very important moment in the church of Jesus that we receive the tithes and the offerings. And also is your opportunity to give your Easter offering. I do believe that last week you received an envelope. All the money that are in envelopes are given to Easter collections. And I want to challenge the Church of Jesus to be faithful to the Lord. Amen. Let us pray.
Father God, we come before you on this holy day, O Lord, to give you all the praise and all the thanks, O Lord. First of all, Lord, we just like to say thank you, Lord, for everything that you do for us and even Amen. More today. We ask you to bless this offering that we're about to take, O Lord, in your heavenly name. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
We hope to see you tonight at 6 p.m. Let us come together and worship the risen Savior. Amen. Let us stand. I would like to invite you to open your Bibles today in the book of Luke chapter 24, verses 1 to 6. Gospel of Luke chapter 24, verses 1 to 6. Amen. The Word of God says, Luke chapter 24, verses 1 to 6. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen." Father, we thank you for your word. May your Holy Spirit guide us through the preaching of your word. And may your Holy Spirit touch people's hearts this afternoon. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Church, this greeting and its response are being celebrated all over the world this weekend. The Church of Jesus Christ has been repeating that same first century greeting every Easter morning for almost 2,000 years. Yes, let us again, Christ is risen. Is risen indeed. All over the world, people are shouting and telling others that we serve a risen Savior. Just think of that. Every generation of Christians since the first have been shouting that truth. The miracle of Christ's resurrection sets Christianity apart from other world religions. Dear friends, I said that before. I want to repeat it again. If I could, I would invite you to join with me traveling around the world to find the grave of the great founders of religions. We would go together to Sri Lanka, the place where the right tooth of Buddha is kept at present. The Buddha's body was cremated and the relics were placed in the monuments or stupas, some of which are believed to have survived until this present day. I took you and we would go together to the town of Shandong, province of China, to find the grave where Confucius is located in the large cemetery where more than 10,000 of his descendants are also buried. We would go to all Masjid, Mosque of the Prophet, in the city of Medina in Saudi Arabia. Muhammad's grave lays with the confines of what used to be his wife, Alicia, and his house. Muhammad is buried next to the first two caliphs, Abu Bakr and Umar. Finally, we would go to Jerusalem, to the tomb where Jesus was buried, and we would find no body or body parts remaining. We would only find an empty tomb, because he has risen from the dead. Hallelujah! Praise his holy name. The word of God let us know that more than 500 eyewitnesses are said to have seen the resurrected Jesus. That is more than a handful. That is more than a dozen or a hundred. 500 people. Think of how many witnesses 500 is. Compare that to how many people are seated in this worship space today. That is how many sets of eyes saw the resurrected Jesus. It was a verified miracle that no one could deny. And we celebrate this miracle today. The first witnesses of Jesus' resurrection were surprised. On the first Easter morning, on the third day after Jesus had been crucified and buried, the angel told the women who came to the tomb, "He is not here. He has risen, as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." Imagine how those women felt as they approached the tomb. We learn the names of the three of the women in Mark chapter 16, verse 1. It says, "When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James and Solomon, bought spices so that they may go to anoint Jesus' body." A fourth is identified by Luke as Joanna in Luke chapter 24, verse 10. As those four women approached the tomb, they must have wondered how they would be able to move the massive stone that has been placed over the entrance. Maybe they thought all four of them together could move it. They had no idea that Jesus would not be there. Even though Jesus predicted his death and resurrection on at least four occasions, they did not expect a resurrection. They were expecting to embalm his body. Think about how Mary Magdalene must have felt. Mark chapter 16, verse 9 claims Jesus cast seven demons of her body. We are not told what torment the demons caused her, but we know she was a loyal follower of Jesus. She witnessed his death and burial, and now she wanted to pay her respect by embalming his body. Joanna was the wife of one of the Herod's officials named Cusar. He was a steward put in charge of Herod's possessions. This means that he was likely wealthy. And Luke chapter 8, verse 3, tells us that Joanna used her husband's good salary to support the ministry of Jesus. She was also one of Jesus' loyal followers, and she too now wanted to mourn and pay respect. Solomon was the mother of the two famous disciples, James and John, who were nicknamed the Son of Thunders. Solomon had previously asked Jesus to grant her sons the right to sit one on each side of Jesus when he established his kingdom. You see, many thought Jesus would lead a military-type rebellion and that Jesus would overthrow the Roman government and that Jesus would establish his throne on earth. Can you imagine how they felt? Now they knew that Jesus was put to death. There was no more hope. Solomon must have been to see Jesus hanging on the cross, rather sitting on a throne. What would happen now to her two sons? Would they too be crucified? The fourth woman was also named Mary. So she was distinguished from Mary Magdalene as Mary, the mother of James. In Mark chapter 16, 1, or Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, in Matthew chapter 27, verse 56. In Matthew chapter 28, he simply calls her the other Mary. We can assume the first readers of the gospel knew who this Mary was, as well as her son, but the information has been lost for many years. We simply do not know much about her, but Jesus knew her because she was one of this group of women who followed Jesus, who heard from him, who heard his teaching and saw his miracles. This group of four women arose early on Sunday morning to show their respect for the hero who had met this tragic and unexpected end. Yes, they were all disappointed. They very likely thought he was going to overthrow the Romans. Instead, he was killed and buried along with their hope. All they could do was come and pay their respects by embalming his dead body with spices. They were disappointed. My question for you, my dear brothers and sisters, have you ever been disappointed in Jesus? Maybe today you believe he has not done what you thought he should do. You prayed for something and nothing happens according to your will. And things started to go in different direction. And you said to yourself, why God, why you did not hear me? Why Jesus, why I do not feel your presence in this moment that I feel hopeless and helpless? There are moments that as a human being, my dear friends, we feel disappointed. You pray and there is no answer. Because sometimes We want the answer according to our will and not according to His will. And let me tell you something, a great truth that we found in the scripture. Even though they were waiting for something great that would happen to them, that through Jesus Christ, Jesus would deliver them from the power of Rome, they never realized that Jesus was able to deliver them from the power of their sins and hell. And this is the message of Easter. We have a Savior who came to die on the cross to deliver us from our sins and also to help us to have a relationship with God the Father. More than to free us. More than to give us security in this world. He promised that He is going to be with us here in this world, but He is going to bring us to His Father home in eternity. Yes, this is a great news. The four women, they were disappointed. It's too late. You remember the other disciples, all disappointed. Too late. We do not believe that things now are going to change. Our leader was put to death. And they approached the tomb. Hopeless. And an angel appeared to tell them, He's not here. He was not in the tomb anymore. Because the word of God says that He rose from the grave. And one thing that is very important for all of us to understand is because Jesus rose from the grave, He gives us also who believe in Him, those who believe in Him one day, the opportunity to be raised from the grave and be reunited with Him forever and ever. Do you believe Him? Is Jesus your Lord and Savior? The message was, go and tell the other disciples. And this is the message for the church today. Go and tell the world that Jesus saves. Go and tell the world that there is hope in Jesus Christ. Go and tell. Do not stay only here. Let people know. If they question you about your faith, if they ask you, how do you know that Jesus lives? Tell them that He lives in you. This morning I talked with Him. It's more than a religion. Sometimes you talk with people about Jesus. They bring their religions. Like to try to stop you. But I'm not here to talk about religions. I'm talking about the one who is Lord. His name is Jesus. Do you know Him? Is Jesus your Lord and Savior? If you die today, do you have the assurance of eternal life? I would like to challenge you to place your life in God's hands. Because only in Jesus' hands you can be safe and secure. Tonight at 6 p.m., we want to invite you to come and join us in this time of celebration. But I want to especially to challenge all the members to call someone else. Go on the church Facebook page, share our invitation. Yesterday I was here with our brother Nate, and we went around the neighborhood to invite people, to let them know there is this great celebration tonight. But especially to let them know that there is a Savior. The message of Easter is that there is a Savior who died on the cross. He went to the tomb and He rose again and He is in heaven. And one day He will come to judge the living and the dead. And we are called to accept Him. The judgment is not because of what Adam and Eve did in the past. Many people question, God, why am I going to pay for what they did? It was not me. It was not my fault. But the Word of God says that now we are being judged because Jesus, who is the light, he came into the world. But the world loved more the darkness than the light. They loved more the world, the things that are happening in this world, than Jesus Christ. If you place your faith in Jesus, you can be saved today. If you open your heart and say, Jesus, today I want to welcome you into my heart. Because when Jesus died on the cross, he died as a substitute for my sin. I was the one who deserved being put to death. But the Word of God says, he took my place. He took your place. And he died for you. The one who didn't have sin, he took my place, that through him I could be considered righteous in God's presence. May God help you to open your eyes and see that, do you really need a Savior? He is the one who can change your life, and he is the one who can bless you. May God bless you. We are going to finish this time with our worship team singing about this truth that he lives in our heart. He lives in me. And if today you want to open your heart to Jesus, could you, before the worship team come and the musicians come, repeat this prayer with me? In your place, could you close your eyes? If you want to say yes to Jesus, repeat with me this prayer. Precious Father, I thank you, Lord, because your Son Jesus died for me on the cross. I thank you, Lord, because he rose again from the grave to assure to me and to all mankind that we can have eternal life. I open my heart to you, and I want to invite you to be my Lord and Savior. I pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. The Word of God let us know that if you prayed this prayer, you can have the assurance of eternal life. It's more than emotion. Is a certainty that we have from the Word of God. May God bless you.
You know we couldn't finish without singing this song. If you're able, church, please stand with us.
Serve a risen Savior, he's in the world today.
church. He
hope to see you this afternoon at 6 p.m. and we want to challenge you to bring someone else, invite someone else, and let us come and worship the Lord together. Convida alguém para estar no nosso serviço às 6 horas e vamos louvar a Deus juntos. Father, we thank you for your presence. We pray, Lord, for your blessings. Help us as a church to continue to proclaim that we serve a risen Savior. His name is Jesus, and He lives in us. Bless your church, bless those who came here. I pray for everyone, Lord, for your blessing upon them. Father, I know that it is a blessing for all of us who can stand in your presence to hear your word. But again, Father, we pray for your blessings upon everybody. In Jesus' name, amen. Yes, I want to welcome all those who came for the first time. There is a big hug from your pastor that represents the whole church to all of you today. Ginger? Oh, Debbie, please come here. We have the tradition to sing someone's whose birthday on Sunday, and she's part of the family of God. Let us sing happy birthday to you before we leave.
Thank you.
Happy birthday to you. Father, we thank you for your presence and for the blessing that we have to be part of the family of God. I pray, Lord, that you bless my sister and help her, Lord, to grow close to thee. We are grateful for the blessing that we have to be part of the family of God. Bless us, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor.
Bless you. Amen. Let us receive the benediction before we leave. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord may His face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face towards you and give you peace. Have a blessed day. Hope to see you tonight at 6 p.m. God bless you.